beginning of the year, Bristol-Myers announced a massive $74 billion takeover for Celgene, the biotech with a huge oncology pipeline. I've been a big believer in this deal ever since CEO Giovanni Caforio came on this show and explained his reasoning earlier this year. Not everyone was on the same page. A starboard value, increasingly prominent activist hedge fund, took a minor stake in Celgene and tried to block the deal. Fortunately, today, Celgene shareholders formally approved the transaction, which means there's one less barrier in the way of the takeover. So let's check back with Giovanni Caforio. He's the chairman and CEO of Bristol-Myers. Get a better sense of the vision about what he's going to do with Celgene. Dr. Caforio, welcome back to Mad Money. Good to see you, sir.
Good to see you.
Thank you, Giovanni. Thank you. Well, I've been thinking about how best to have our viewers get excited about this. And I'm thinking you basically are creating a new youth company. You've got existing drugs that are winning. But then you've also created a company that has so much in the pipeline. I think you should talk about that pipeline, how big it could be.
Well, Jim, let me say first, we're very pleased with the outcome of today's vote. We are getting one step closer to creating that great company.
And when do you think final?
Third quarter. We're confident in the third quarter. And when the two companies come together, we have two growing businesses, great people. We're going to be able to launch six new medicines potentially in the next 2 years. It's going to be a great company, create value for shareholders, very good for patients.
So talk about some of the five, because I think that this comes down to, I mean, by the way, Giovanni tells you everything, plays totally transparent. Anyone can look at this. You know, when I look at these, Celgene provides five late-stage products with near-term approvals. You are not braggadocio, but I will tell you I see multiple billions on this one page.
Well, Jim, that's really the value of the deal is the pipeline. And we talk about five pipeline assets, potential launches in the next 2 years. In fact, three of those medicines have been filed with the FDA since the beginning of the year. So we're making great progress already, which is validating our thesis. Four of those are in hematology, an area that Celgene knows really well. As you know, Celgene is a leader in multiple myeloma. Right. Four of those medicines have the potential to be really transformational.
Why do you think that Bristol-Myers stock has not gone up in the sense that you and I would think it has? Maybe it's starboard tainted it, but you have earnings power for multiple years before you even have the new drugs take over. I mean, this is the lowest multiple drug company. This is Bristol-Myers. I don't get it.
So, Jim, I'm focused and we're focused on creating value for the long term.
I know, but I'm, you know.
And we're getting to work on the integration. Okay. We're very focused on the integration. We're going to bring the two companies together well. As we start working together, we have an opportunity to launch new medicines right away. I believe the value of the new company will be demonstrated rapidly. Mm-hmm. And again, I think in this deal, there is a lot of value for shareholders.
Okay, so how worried do we have to be about Revlimid in the deck that you created? You do have a down year coming up out there.
Well, you know, we've been conservative, of course, because we know that Revlimid is going to lose exclusivity. Right. But again, in the last 2 months, there have been two opinions from the patent office that have been positive. There has been an agreement, as you know, between Celgene and a generic company, which really validates our theory. So we're confident that we've taken the right approach. And obviously, that was important to us. But remember, we are acquiring Celgene because of the strength of the pipeline and the ability to sustain the growth of the company for the long term.
A lot of times people are worried about a balance sheet after a takeover. Tell me if I'm wrong. I think your balance sheet is actually stronger the day the deal closes.
Yeah, we'll have strong financial flexibility. The cash flow of the combined company in the first 3 years is over $45 billion of free cash flow. We'll be able to delever quickly and pay the debt. So the company will be able to continue to be really flexible from a financial perspective, and that's from day one.
How about immunotherapy? We know that so many companies are paying huge multiples for immunotherapy. Celgene seems to have a ton of it, and nobody's talking about it.
Yeah, well, first of all, let me say, we are one of the leading companies in immunotherapy. Opdivo is a very strong franchise, and on our side at Bristol-Myers Squibb, we've got 20 registrational studies coming. So the growth of Opdivo will continue to be fueled by new data in multiple tumor types. And in the pipeline of both companies, in fact, in the pipeline of Bristol-Myers Squibb going forward, there will be many opportunities to continue to strengthen our presence in immunotherapy. So that remains a really big area of focus for us.
Just like I asked about Revlimid, Opdivo, where are we in terms of major concern that things just kind of just don't stack up against Keytruda.
So let me just say, first of all, Opdivo is a very successful medicine. It's a foundational treatment in cancer. We have approval in 16 indications. Key indications we have, we are the market leader. We have multiple studies that are going to be reading out beginning this year in lung cancer, following up in many new tumors. And then in the medium and the long term, we have a leading program in early disease, something called the adjuvant treatment of cancer. There is significant potential there. So I see Opdivo as a growing franchise. We're doing very well.
When Celgene bought Receptos, I believe that ozanimod was one of the biggest drugs, could be one of the biggest drugs of all time. Something happened where it fell back. Was it anything that would made it so you can't get the do-over? And irritable bowel, we don't have anything good. This was supposed to be best in class. Can it be?
Well, first of all, let me say I'm really pleased that it was filed again with the FDA. I think that's an important step. We looked at ozanimod as a really important part of the deal. We believe it is a potentially a great medicine. The first indication, as you know, will be multiple sclerosis. Right. But there is some early data that is very promising in inflammatory bowel disease. The unmet medical need in both of those areas is very, very big. And ozanimod potentially is a really important product. So there has been progress in the first quarter with the filing with the FDA, but there's more to come.
Now, when that deal was done, I was surprised that after the submission right after was it done poorly? What happened? Because I tainted everybody's view of this excellent drug.
It is an excellent molecule, and we looked at that a lot in due diligence. We're happy that it was filed with the FDA again, and I think it's on a good path.
Within 6 months, a year, what do you think?
Well, that depends on the FDA, and it's difficult to say.
Unmet needs, they move fast these days.
Right.
Anyway, this is the cheapest I've ever seen Bristol during that Plavix period, and that was a different kind of company, not your kind of company. That's Giovanni Caforio. He's the chairman and CEO of Bristol-Myers Squibb. And I've got to tell you, you want a drug stock, not when it's soaring, but when they're giving it away. Mad Money's back after the break. Booyah! Jim Cramer here from Mad Money. Thanks for watching CNBC on YouTube. Click here to subscribe and get the jump on my exclusives with CEOs, plus market news, investing advice, and a whole lot more.